But before we do that, I want to welcome our friends on YouTube. I'm so glad that you're here with us, studying God's Word, listening to this message. It is our prayer that God's Word would build you up, that would encourage you. I want to welcome any visitors we have here today. Welcome. I want to welcome Eugenie back from vacation. And of course, we want to keep the Rosbergs in our prayers as they're on vacation and others, because this is that time of year when we get away and rest and play. And it's important to do that. Okay, but so anyways, I want to welcome you all in the name of Jesus Christ. And the first thing, before we turn to the scriptures, I'd just like to ask you a question. And the reason why I want to ask you a question is because I don't believe in coincidence. There are Jewish people who say coincidence is not a kosher word. And I believe that. I don't believe that there is coincidence. I believe in divine appointment. And I believe that you are here today by divine appointment. And my prayer for you is that you will get something out of this message. That God would be able to minister in some way, somehow, to you. And so my question today is, who or what are you counting on for your future? Let me ask that again. Who or what are you counting on for your future? God has blessed me with a life of 52, almost 53 years. Doesn't seem that long. It just seemed like yesterday. I was 17 years old playing basketball in the streets of Warnoco, and here I am, some 35, 36 years later, standing before you all, preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so I've lived long enough to know that if there is one constant in life, it's change. You're not going to get away from change. No matter how much you hedge your bets, no matter how much you build your kingdom, no matter what you do, change is inevitable. And like most people, we don't really like change. Change is usually not comfortable to us unless we're the ones instituting the change. When we're the ones changing things, we're okay with that, because in our mind, we're correcting something that is amiss. But if we are the ones receiving the change, we don't like it, because we can't figure that they're telling us that there's something wrong with me, and I don't want to hear that. And one of the things that I've noticed about our American culture is that we're very good at burying our head in the sand and tuning out what's important. And a lot of it has to do with the nature of our culture. We have a very fast-paced culture. We have computers, we have iPads, iPhones, we have, sporting events, we have rock concerts, we have summertime events, we have camping, we have all these vacations, jobs, businesses. We worry about foreign affairs, we wonder what our children are going to face in the future. There's a lot that is coming at us. And so my question to you again is, what are you counting on, or who are you counting on for your future? Now, this is a question that does bother some people. And it has led to people feeling, well, what's the point? Life is meaningless. There's this endless parade of events that I seem to have no control over. And so what is even the point of living life? Or, I'm going to eat, drink, and be merry because tomorrow I may die. Or, I can't deal with life, so I'm going to put a needle in my vein or snuff some chemical up my nose or ingest some type of prescription medication because I just want to check out from life in general. I'd be saying, well, Nelson, I'm a Christian, so I don't have that attitude. I don't know about that. I think the Church of Jesus Christ finds other ways to check out. And so the question again is, who or what are we depending on for our future. And of course, as good Christians, we come up with the Sunday school answer, Jesus, right? We're depending on Jesus. Jesus is going to take care of our future. Well, what specifically do you mean by that? And does God have a message for the world today about Jesus taking care of our future? And I believe it does. So if you turn with me in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 9. We're going to start at verse 9. And while you're turning in your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Did I say Corinthians? I'm sorry. See, you got to pay attention, okay? Because my flesh is going to try to trip you up, okay? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 9, with in our minds the concept of how is my future going to be laid out and who will determine what my future is. 1 Thessalonians, if you did not know, was the very first book penned in the New Testament. You may say, well, Pastor, Matthew is the first book in the New Testament. I thought that was the first book. No, it's not. Matthew was not the first book written by the New Testament writers. Actually, 1 Thessalonians was the very first book written in the New Testament. And that is agreed upon by most evangelical scholars. There are a few who think maybe Galatians might have been penned before 1 Thessalonians, but most evangelical scholars believe that 1 Thessalonians is the first New Testament book written. And before we read, let me just give you a little bit of background on this book. It was written not even 20 years after Jesus Christ ascended into heaven. That's pretty close to the ascension of Jesus Christ. And also, this book has 5 chapters in it, and every single chapter in 1 Thessalonians deals with the second coming of Jesus Christ. Well, preacher, what are you talking about, second coming? Well, history has told us that there was a man by the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Most people are aware of him. You guys are probably, you know, like, this is redundant. Can you move on? But you know what? I don't want to take any chances because maybe not all of you know about this Jesus. And I'm here to tell you, point blank, there is more evidence, more historical proof that Jesus Christ lived when Christians say he lived than any other person in the history of mankind, including Julius Caesar, the leader of the Roman Empire. There's more evidence. There is an abundance of evidence, and it's not all evidence given by Christians. There are secular sources that also confirm that Jesus Christ was a legit person, and the things that he did were very legit, okay? So I just want to say that, because you know what? In America, we used to teach people that the Bible was God's word. There was no doubt about that for the longest time in the earliest annals of our country. And it wasn't until about the 1800s that some German rationalists came up with the concept, well, the whole Bible isn't God's word, it just contains God's word. And I'm here to tell you, that's a lie. All scripture is God-breathed and is profitable for doctrine. What is doctrine? What you believe. I believe that this carpet is red. That's what my eyes are telling me. Therefore, my doctrine would be the carpet is red. If I thought the carpet was blue, then my doctrine would be that the carpet is blue. So what is your doctrine about Jesus Christ? And who are you depending upon for your future? And I'm here to give you what I believe is God's message of hope to a hopeless world. And so here in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 9, Paul writes this. He says, but concerning brotherly love, you have no need that I should write to you. For you yourselves are taught by God to love one another. And indeed you do so towards all the brethren who are in Macedonia. But we urge you, brethren, that you increase more and more, that you aspire to lead a quiet life, to mind your own business,
to work with your own hands as we have commanded you, and that you should walk properly towards those who are outside, that you may lack nothing. Let's stop there for a second. We're going to continue on. But Paul here is writing to the Thessalonian Christians. And to give you a little bit more background on this church, these were brand new Christians. We would call them baby Christians. See, Jesus saved me when I was 11 years old. You do the math. I've been walking with Jesus for 41 years, so that makes me not a baby. I'm a mature Christian. Or am I? I don't know. The jury's still out on that. But these believers were in Christ about 6 months when Paul wrote this letter. Okay? And he wrote this letter because there was a shift in the geopolitical landscape that was going on. And you're saying, well, Nelson, you're throwing around these $30 words. What are you talking about? What I'm talking about is, if you study church history, in the very beginning of the history of the church, persecution given towards the Christians did not come from the Romans. It actually came from the Sanhedrin, the Jewish leadership. Okay, but by this time, some 19 years after Christ was resurrected and ascended, the persecution was coming from a different source. It was now starting to come from the Romans. The Romans were demanding that people worship Caesar as God. And obviously these Christians knew that you shall have no other gods before me, and so they wouldn't do it. And because the Christians would not worship Caesar as God, the Romans began to persecute them. And if you're a student of the scriptures at all, if you understand the book of Daniel, the book of Daniel makes it very clear that the Antichrist, the man of sin, the son of perdition, the king of fierce countenance, the little horn of Daniel 7, the little horn of Daniel 8, whatever title, he has over 33 titles. We choose Antichrist, okay? That's the most popular one. But if you understand the book of Daniel, you know that the Antichrist is going to come from the Roman Empire. And here you have a Roman emperor persecuting the Christians. So you had false teachers telling the Thessalonians, Nero's the Antichrist, you are in the tribulation, and that freaked them out. Wouldn't that freak you out? Most of you, I think, are old enough, but maybe some of you aren't quite old enough to remember 9/11. But for those of us who remember 9/11, how did that make you feel? It scared you, didn't it? It freaked you out. Because that was a national catastrophe. That was something that glared right at us from our TV screens. And a lot of Christians were freaking out thinking, oh my God, is this the end of the world? And the Word of God doesn't want us to walk in that kind of fear. God wants to give us hope. He wants to give us love. He wants to give us faith. Those are the three hallmarks of the church. Faith, love, and hope. Faith looks back to a resurrected Savior. Love looks up to a crowned Savior. And hope looks forward to a coming Savior. What am I talking about? We become born again, you know, at the risk of using Christianese, we become born again when by faith we look back some 2,000 years at Jesus Christ and we believe that he is the Son of God. We believe that he rose from the dead. We believe that he ascended to the Father's throne. And we believe that he died and became sin for us so that we could become righteous before God. That's faith looking back to a resurrected Savior. Love looks up to a crowned Savior. What does that mean? Jesus said, if you love me, you will obey me. So if you love Jesus Christ, you look up to Jesus and say, I want to obey you and follow you all the days of my life. But it doesn't end there. If you have hope, you look forward to the coming Savior. Because my friends, Jesus Christ is coming back to planet Earth. And the question is, are you ready to meet him? I want you to know something. I'm ready to meet him.
And I know Dr. Jeremiah is ready to meet him because I was watching his sermon this morning on TV, and he was talking about how he is one of God's people and that he knows that God is coming for him. And I know that God is coming for me. And there are some people who don't like the fact that I know that God is coming for us. There are some people who don't like that hope. Why? I believe it's because they don't have hope. And so if you don't have hope, I am here today, hopefully, to give you hope. Not because I'm so great, but because the God I serve is the God of all hope. And so, where does it all begin for the Christian? Jesus said to his disciples, the two greatest commandments are this: you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and you shall love your neighbor as you love yourself. There's a lot of loving going on in there. We need to love God first and foremost. In fact, Jesus says your love for God should be so intense that your love for anyone else or for yourself seems like hatred. Let me say that again, because I don't want you to misinterpret me here. Our love for God should be so intense that our love for ourselves and our love for our loved ones should, in comparison, seem like hatred. Okay? I'm not saying that we should hate ourselves, and I'm not saying we should hate our loved ones. What I'm saying is our love for God should far outweigh any love that we have for anything or anyone in this world. It goes back to, who are you depending on for your future? And so Paul here in verse 9 says, but concerning brotherly love, I have no need that I should write to you. These baby Christians were doing really good. And remember, I mentioned they were about 6 months old in Christ. There were false teachers who were telling them they were in the middle of the tribulation, that Nero was the Antichrist, and they were freaking out. They were like, oh my gosh, some of our loved ones have died. Did they miss the rapture? What's going to happen? And they were very, very upset about the death of those loved ones who were Christians who had died. And so their question is, what's going to happen to them? And Paul wrote this letter to counteract the false teachers who were teaching these people opposite and contrary to the way Paul had taught them. And as we get along in this passage, we'll see that Paul is reminding them of what he taught them. But one thing for sure, even though they were under persecution, they were abounding in love. This letter is a very warm letter. You should sit down one day and read the whole letter. It's just 5 chapters long. It probably take you maybe a half an hour, if that. Okay? And it's just a very warm letter that Paul wrote to a very vibrant group of Christians who were just kind of upset by some things that they had seen and had been taught by people who were not looking out for their best interests. And so Paul says, concerning brotherly love, I have no need to write to you. You yourselves are taught by God to love one another. That's so true. Jesus himself. Indeed, you do so towards all the brethren who are in Macedonia. But we urge you, brother, that you increase the more and more. Let me tell you something. One of my prayers for this church is that we would abound in love. Amen. That we would love one another. Jesus said in John 13:35, he said, truly, they, the world, will know that you are my disciples by your love that you have one for another. I want the world to know that this is a Jesus church. I want the world to know that we are Christians. In fact, the hallmark of the first century Christians was that, look how these Christians love one another. Because I know that upon love rest all the law and the prophets. If we are loving one another, we're going to be obedient to God. We're going to obey God. In fact, Jesus even said, if you love me, you'll obey me. So love really is the pump that primes all of God's righteousness and power and joy and hope and peace in our lives. And Paul says to these baby Christians, he says, you are exceeding in all this. Your reputation goes out all over the place. But he says, I encourage you to do more, to love more. We should never, ever rest on our laurels. In fact, the most dangerous thing a Christian can do is rest on their laurels. We need to constantly run the race. You know, there's a crown for those who run the race with endurance, and not for those who quit. And I know you guys aren't quitters, okay? I know you're running this race. You may sit down for a little bit, but I know you get back up and you start running again. you know? And that's okay, because God is gracious, God is merciful, He knows that we are but flesh, and He wants to be there for us. Let's continue on. Verse 11. He says that you should aspire to lead a quiet life, to mind your own business, to work with your own hands as we commanded you, that you may walk properly towards those who are outside, that you may lack nothing. God wants us to walk properly towards outsiders. Who are the outsiders? People who are not Christians. Oh, preacher, you're divisive. You're separating people into two groups. No, actually, the Word of God separates us into three groups. Paul says that we are to give no offense to the Jews, we're to give no offense to the Gentiles, and we're to give no offense to the church. And you might say, well, how does that work? Well, anyone who's Jewish and is unsaved is in the first category. Anyone who's not Jewish and is unsaved is in category two. Everyone who is saved, whether Jew or Gentile, is in category three. The church of God. You might be saying, well, what is the church? The church is the ecclesia, the called out ones. God has called us out of the world to Himself. Okay? So we're supposed to walk properly towards those outside of the church so that we lack nothing. What is He talking about? He's talking about our witness. If we don't walk properly before people in the world, when we go to witness to them, we're going to lack everything, mostly integrity. Okay? And they're not going to listen to us. But if they see how we love one another, and they see the integrity that only God can give us, it will speak to them that there is a God in heaven. Now, if you're having some problems with integrity, don't beat yourself up over it. You have a bar of soap. It's called 1 John 1:9. And it says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Just God, ask God to forgive you. And guess what? You're clean. And every time I say that, I think of this old Petra song singing, I'm clean, I'm clean, I'm clean before my Lord. You know, it's just incredible how God, you know, allows us to make mistakes, but always provides a way to deal with the mistake. And so these Christians are freaking out because Paul understood the power of hope. And this next verse is so important. Verse 13 of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, not Corinthians, Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, Paul says, but I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. Let's stop there for a second. And this is part of my first point. We are not to be ignorant. In fact, we are not ignorant, but orderly. And what I mean by that is this. First of all, God wants you to know what's going on. He doesn't want you to be ignorant. And I looked up that word ignorant, and it comes from the Greek word aganeo, and it means to be ignorant, to not know, to not understand, to be wrong. Okay? In the 90s, it was very fashionable for highfalutin people to say to one another, I'm an agnostic, okay? Meaning, I don't know if there is a God or if there's not a God, but I'm an agnostic, you know? And they thought that was, you know, that's so cool and so hip, and, you know, it's like, yeah, brother, you know? And the funny thing is, the word agnostic actually comes from the same Greek word for ignorant. I guess that wouldn't go over, I'm an ignoramus, you know? That's what someone who claims to be an agnostic is basically saying. That they don't know. That they're wrong in their understanding of life. See, this English Bible of ours, I'm, you know, for you old timers, I'm going to shock you here. Jesus didn't speak in King James. Blasphemy! He didn't speak in King James. He spoke in Greek, Aramaic. Okay? And so sometimes a bit is lost in the translation. That's why I take the time to delve into the Greek to give you a little bit of a clearer understanding of what's being said. Because I know some of you, you've heard me quote this passage a million times, like, oh no, Nelson's on the rapture kick again and stuff. But I want you to know, I feel like Paul. It is good for me to remind you of these things continually. Because it's good news. It's It's not bad news. If it was bad news, I'd just tell you once and pray for you. But it's good news. I want to keep reminding you of the good news that is your possession as believers in Jesus Christ. And not only does Paul say, I don't want you to be ignorant concerning those who have fallen asleep, and you'll be saying, well, why is Paul concerned about people who are asleep? That's not what Paul is saying here. What Paul is saying is, I don't want you to be ignorant concerning those of your friends in Christ who have died. It's a euphemism for death. And my evidence for that is in the Gospel of John, chapter 11. Lazarus and Mary and Martha were a family close to Jesus. And Lazarus got sick. And Jesus heard about it, but he stayed away from Lazarus for 3 days. And then Lazarus died. And after 3 days, Jesus said to his disciples, hey, let's get up. We got to go see Lazarus. He's sleeping. And his disciples go, well, Lord, if he's sleeping, he'll wake up again. And Jesus says, no, he's dead. It was a divine appointment for Jesus to raise Lazarus from the dead. And so what Paul is talking about is, I don't want you to be ignorant concerning your friends in Christ who have died. I don't want you to be ignorant. What does Paul want for these Christians? He says, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. And I looked up the word sorrow and hope. And I want to share this with you. The word sorrow here comes from the Greek word lepio. It means to make sorrowful, to affect with sadness, to cause grief, to throw into sorrow, to grieve, to offend, to make one uneasy. God doesn't want you to be sorrowful. Now, he recognizes there is a period of mourning, but God wants to bring you out of that. And if you know most people are depressed, are just in a constant state of sorrow, that's not God's will. God doesn't want you depressed. God doesn't want you grieved. He doesn't want you uneasy. What does he want for you? Hope. Hope. And I worked up. There I go again. Oh. I looked up the word hope or comfort. Okay, as it, actually, yeah, the word, I did not look up the word hope, so we'll take that back. I thought I did, but we didn't, okay? But God wants you to have hope, okay? Verse 14, it says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who are asleep or dead in Jesus. In other words, Paul is saying to these Christians, look, you're not in the tribulation. Nero is not the Antichrist. Remember what I taught you? I don't want you to be ignorant. I don't want you to be an ignoramus. I don't want you to be wrong about this. I want you to be right. And so what God has given to me through divine revelation, this is Paul talking, not me, is that if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, them which are dead in Christ will God bring with him. Why would God be bringing the dead in Christ with him? We're going to find out as we read on, okay? But I'm here to tell you, Jesus is coming back. And he's coming back with the dead in Christ with him. In fact, at the end of 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, Paul says, First Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 13, he says, to the end, may he establish you, speaking to the Thessalonians, the Christians, may he establish you blameless in purity at the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ with all his saints. I happen to have a dad who loved Jesus who has died. I have uncles and aunts that love Jesus and have died. I have a baby brother that died at 8 months old. He was a little bit younger than me. I was about a year older than him. He died at 8 months old. His name is Matthew. He's in Christ. They're in Christ. One day Jesus is going to bring all those people back to me. And he's going to bring all your dead, faithful dead in Christ back to you. If you have a good friend or a relative or whatever who was a Christian and has died, it's not the end of the story for them. And God's going to bring them back to you. Amen. If that doesn't bring you hope and comfort, I don't know what will. But let's continue on. We are orderly but not ignorant. God wants Christians to love one another. He wants Christians to walk properly. And he wants Christians to have hope that even transcends death itself. And I know some of you say, well, I do. To live is Christ, to die is gain. Okay, wonderful. What about the people you leave behind? Okay? How does God give them hope? The rapture.
Amen.
Because he promises to reunite you one day with your loved ones.
And so next we want to look at raptured but not caught unaware. In verse 15 it says, "For this we say to you by the word of the Lord."
This is not Paul's opinion. This was God's word given to him. Okay? It has complete divine authority. There is no, you know, in our Bible studies, I'm constantly throwing out tips on how to study the Bible. They're called hermeneutical tips. And hermeneutics is the ability to interpret Scripture. And there's a very simple hermeneutical rule, okay? If when you read a passage, if it makes sense, don't seek any other sense, because you might just get nonsense. Let me say that again. If the initial sense makes common sense, seek no other sense, lest you get nonsense. And that's what some people do. And there's another little rule that goes along with it. If you torture the text long enough, you can get it to confess to anything. And that's why whenever I preach from the Word of God, I try to give you other scripture passages that connect to what is being said, because the best way not to torture the text is to use other scripture passages to back up what you're saying and preaching in a particular sermon. And I hope you guys are like the Bereans, Acts 17:11. It says the Bereans were more noble than the Thessalonians in that they received the word of God with all readiness of mind, but searched the scriptures daily to see if these things are so. And so we don't want to torture the text, and we don't want to, you know, drive ourselves nuts. If it makes complete sense to you, why pursue any other interpretation? Now, I'm not saying that you can't go into the Greek and get a deeper understanding of the interpretation like we just did, but I mean, it's pretty open. The word of the Lord says what? It says that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. Because these false teachers were telling the Thessalonians, guess what? Your loved ones are going to get left behind. And Paul says, no. I've been given God's word that they will not, that you will, that if we're alive when the rapture occurs, we're not going to go before those who are dead in Christ. They go first. What are you talking about going? I thought you said God's going to bring them with him. Yeah, he is. God's going to bring the spirits and the souls of the dead in Christ, and he's going to resurrect their bodies that are in the dirt, but he's not going to turn them into the night of the living dead, okay? He's going to make those bodies brand new. They're going to be, resurrected bodies, just like Jesus' body. And that's not all. God's going to take us who are alive, and he's going to give us resurrection bodies at the same time. And that's why Paul can assure us that our salvation is without doubt, because if you remember a couple weeks ago, we were given the Holy Spirit as a deposit, as a guarantee. Well, not just a few weeks ago, but we learned a few weeks ago that the Spirit was given to us as a deposit or as a guarantee. And that same Spirit reaffirms to us that this is true, that Jesus Christ is going to raise us from the dead if we die. And if we don't, he's going to raise us from life to life. That means there's a generation of Christians who won't die. Remember when I said change is inevitable? So is death and taxes, right? Death is inevitable except for those who are in Christ. Because Jesus said, if you believe in me, though you die, yet you shall live. And there are some Christians who won't even have to endure physical death at all. They're going to get raptured. That's good news.
Amen.
That's good news. Okay, so let's continue on what Paul is telling us here. In verse 16, he says, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of the archangel, and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first." And there we have. Jesus is going to descend with a shout. You know, God gave me a vision of this. I was in a church service up in Toronto, Canada, and the Holy Spirit came upon me. I was in a worship service. And he gave me a vision of the rapture. And I remember seeing myself standing like this with my arms like this. And I could see Jesus Christ descending with a shout. And I could somehow, the Holy Spirit had anointed my eyes, I could look around the entire world. I could see every Christian in the world doing the same thing. We're all doing this. And he shouted, and we all came up to him. Kind of like, the only thing I can compare it to, it's hard to describe in words, is if you've ever watched Star Trek, and when the spaceship goes into warp drive and becomes light, that's what it was like. It was like we all just kind of became light, and we were in his presence.
Amen.
And then right after that vision, I had a second vision. And the second vision, I was on a white horse with wings. And I was in a V formation with millions and millions and millions of people. And there was one person leading the V formation. And his countenance was so bright you couldn't even look at him. And the Holy Spirit says, that's Jesus leading the second coming. The time when Jesus Christ is going to literally come back to the earth to set up his kingdom. You see, the rapture is different. The rapture, Jesus comes for his own. The second coming, Jesus comes with his own. And they're separated by a seven-year period called the tribulation. But anyways, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then what? Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Thus shall we always be with the Lord.
Amen.
When this happens, we will never be separated from God ever again. There will be no separation from our loved ones. There'll be no tears. There'll be no more pain. There'll be no more death. There'll be no more destruction. There'll be no more war. There will be no more injustice. We will be in the presence of Almighty God. We will have resurrected bodies. We will be able to worship Him and do probably more tasks than we can imagine. I think we have no concept, no understanding how incredible our glorified bodies are going to be. I think that's why Paul wrote, "Eye has not seen and ear has not heard what God has prepared for those who love Him." I don't think we truly understand. But on the same note, I don't think we understand how much is being held back that is evil. Because the Holy Spirit is restraining a whole lot of evil. And I know it may sound like, it doesn't seem like He's restraining much evil today. But I'm telling you, the evil that is going to come is going to make what's going on right now seem like a picnic. People are going to wish for these days when the wrath of God is being poured out upon the earth after the rapture of the church of Jesus Christ. And Paul says in verse 18, he says, therefore, comfort one another with these words. And I did look up the word comfort, and that word comfort comes from the Greek word parakleo, and it means, it's very close to the comforter, the paraclete, the Holy Spirit. And that word comfort in the Greek, it means to admonish, exhort, console, encourage, strengthened by consolation, comfort, instruct, and teach. People who have taken the rapture and turned it into a divisive doctrine, people who argue over the rapture, you know what I say to you? The Lord rebuke you. Because it's not supposed to be a doctrine of controversy. It's not supposed to be a doctrine of dissension. It's not supposed to be a doctrine of apprehension. It's supposed to be a doctrine of hope. And that's what God has called us to call people into His glorious hope. Let's keep reading on. And I know it's getting late, but you know what? The next chapter, we need to go into the next chapter. You realize these chapters and verses weren't originally in the original text. They were added in the Middle Ages. And I believe a lot of people stop and say, oh, that's the passage of the rapture. You know what? The next few verses are still talking about the same subject, but in relation to the second coming. In verse 1 of chapter 5, Paul says, but concerning the times and seasons, brethren, I have no need to write that I should write to you. Why? Because in Matthew 24:44, you know what Jesus said to his disciples as he was preparing to leave the earth? He said, keep watch for my return. Watch and pray. Watch and pray. In fact, in Luke chapter 12, he says, if you do this, then I will have you sit down at a table, and I myself, meaning Jesus, will serve you a meal. The Christian who is watching and praying for the Lord's return, I believe, is going to be given a very special banquet. I don't know if all Christians are going to be a part of that banquet. A lot of people say, well, yeah, that's the marriage supper of the Lamb. Is it? Because there are other passages where it seems like some Christians are getting blessed, And others are kind of being left out a little bit. And I'm not talking about eternal life. I'm talking about rewards. Eternal life, we can't do anything about eternal life. Jesus Christ is the author and finisher of our faith. If you're born again, you can't lose your salvation. If you truly know Jesus Christ, you're in like Flint, okay? But the question is, what kind of rewards will you enjoy in eternity? There are five crowns, at least, that we know of. And like I said, one of them is a crown of those who keep running the race, who don't stop. And so here, Paul is saying, look, I don't need to write to you because you know you're supposed to be keeping a weather eye on the horizon for the return of Jesus Christ. The world isn't doing that. And you know what? Unfortunately, carnal Christians aren't either. They aren't looking for the return of Jesus Christ. And I believe that God, in my ministry, has called me to the church to remind the church, are you watching? Are you looking? Are you praying for his return? Because if you're not, and you're a Christian, shame on you. You're being disobedient. You're being naughty. And let me tell you something. Jesus is going to take you to the woodshed and spank your behind. Okay? So don't be naughty. Watch and pray for the return of Jesus Christ. And Paul says, I don't have to, you know, these guys were doing it. Okay? Verse 2, he says, for you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. The rapture of the church is signless. Nothing has to happen for the rapture to happen. In other words, let me put it to you this way. Jesus could come back right now. There doesn't have to be a prophecy. There doesn't have to be a sign in heaven. There doesn't have to be anything to occur. Jesus could come back right now. In fact, Jesus could have come back in the first century, but he didn't. He could have come back in the second century, but he didn't. He could have come back in all the rest of those centuries, but he didn't. But what did he tell his disciples? Watch and pray. And some of you might be saying, well, come on, preacher. It's been almost 2,000 years. How long are we supposed to do this? I'll tell you how long, till he comes.
Amen.
He didn't put a time limit on it. Well, you know, if it's 1,500 years, you can stop watching and praying because, you know, I'm not coming back for a long time. Nowhere in the Bible does it ever tell us that Jesus isn't coming back for a long time. And you might be saying, well, that's weird. It has been a long time. But you've got to understand God. He's eternal. 1,000 years is nothing to him. 2,000 years is nothing to him. Because he's eternal. He's outside of time. You see, that's part of the problem. We've turned God into a man. We've conformed God into our image instead of allowing him to conform us into his image. And so we developed this cynicism. And you know what? The Bible knows, the Bible has an answer for that type of cynicism. And the Holy Spirit was ready for that type of criticism. Turn with me in your Bibles to 2 Peter chapter 3. God has an answer to the cynics who don't believe in the rapture, who don't believe that it's coming back. Let me tell you something. There are theologians who say the rapture doesn't exist. It's not a real doctrine. It's never mentioned in the Bible. The word rapture is never mentioned. And you know what? In your English Bibles, they're right. You'll never find the word rapture in a Bible. But let me ask you this. Does the Bible teach about the Trinity? Does it teach that there's a Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, that they're all God? If you don't know what it does, you need to read the book, because it does. But nowhere in the Bible does it ever use the word Trinity, but it certainly teaches about the Trinity. And you know what? Nowhere in the Bible does it specifically say rapture, unless you have a Latin Bible, and then it's going to use the word rapturo, okay, which is what we get our English word rapture from, okay? But the Bible certainly teaches about the rapture, even in the very first book of the Bible. Because in Genesis chapter 5, but it's talking about Enoch. It says, Enoch walked with God, and then Enoch was not because God took him. What does that mean? God raptured Enoch. He took him out of the, because that's what rapture means. It means to snatch up. It comes from the Greek word harpazo, which means to be caught up. And so Paul is saying, we who are alive and remain, we're going to be caught up with the dead. The dead are going to rise, are going to be caught up first, and then we are going to be caught up with them. And you say, well, how long, what's the difference of time? The twinkle of an eye. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 says, it says the dead will be raised, and then we who are alive, will, in a twinkling of an eye, will be raptured with them, raised to immortality. And so Paul is continuing, or Peter here has an answer to the cynic. Okay, in verse 9 it says, the Lord is not slack
in his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. Therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to live, to be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be dissolved, being on fire, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Actually, you know what? I forgot some verses. We need to back up. I'm sorry. Verse 9 was the last verse. I went to verse 3. Yeah, I'm sorry. See, the mind, you know, you gotta keep on top of it. Verse 3 of 2 Peter says, knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days, walking according to their own lusts, saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue on as they were from the beginning. For this they willfully forget that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of water in water, by which the world that then existed perished, being flooded with water. But the heavens and earth, which are now preserved by the same word, are preserved for fire until the day of judgment and the perdition of ungodly men. But, beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And what Peter is saying here is that God was merciful to you and to me. Think about it. If the rapture had occurred 60 years ago, how many of us would have been part of that rapture? Most of you aren't old enough to participate in that world, never mind being Christ for 60 years, okay? There might be a few of you who might have been, you know, little babies or something, you know. You guys look good for your age, though, I'm telling you. You're doing a great job. Keep doing what you're doing. Keep loving Jesus, okay? But we would have been left out. But because God withheld the time of the rapture, he gave us time to get saved. He gave us time to be a part of that. God is patient, not willing that any should perish. And so God has, you know, God has an answer to all genuine questions. I know some people get a little bit jaded and like, oh God, where are you? You know what? God has an answer for every single prayer you have. It's in the Word of God somewhere. You just need to find it. And that's part of being a Christian. And that's why we do Bible studies. It's amazing how I don't do all the Bible studies. I don't teach all the Bible studies. And yet I'm told time after time, I'll be preparing a sermon and someone will say to me, you know what? They were discussing that very same issue in Bible study. Well, preacher, you must send out word. No, I don't. I'm very laissez-faire about that kind of thing. I let the Holy Spirit give the orders. Okay? I do what God's called me to do. I teach, you know, several Bible studies, but I don't teach all of them. Because it's not a one-man show. It's the body of Christ working together. And you know what? Part of that is understanding that we have a blessed hope that we're supposed to be looking for. And in verse 3, Paul begins to talk about the world. Now, in verse 3, it says, when they... See, he's making a difference between the Thessalonians and them. He says, for when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction shall come upon them as labors upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness so that this day should overtake you as a thief. You are all sons of the light and sons of the darkness. We are not of the night nor of the darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. Does it say there, oh, just kick back and relax because Jesus isn't coming back for a long time? No, it says let us watch and be sober. And I'm not just talking about physical soberness, I'm talking about spiritual soberness as well. Yeah, you shouldn't be getting bombed all the time. If you're getting drunk out of your mind, you're sinning. Okay? The Bible says do not be, you know, filled with wine. Do not be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. Okay? We're not supposed to get bombed all the time. We're supposed to be sober. And we're supposed to be watching. And we're supposed to be praying. And that's what Paul was exhorting these young Christians to do. Be sober, be of sober mind. And that's my thesis. We Christians are to keep watch for the return of Jesus Christ with a sober mind. And you know what? I happened to look up that word sober. Okay? If I can find it.
I did not look up that word. I lied again. Oh, no, I did. Sober, okay? It comes from the Greek word netho, and it means to be sober, but listen to this, to be calm and collected in spirit.
Amen.
A Christian should never be off balance when it comes to end time events. Let me share with you a personal example. I am old enough to remember 9/11, okay? That happened, what, 15, 14 years ago, okay? So I was in my late 30s, all right? And I remember 9/11 hitting. And I remember, you know, the towers being hit. And I remember everyone freaking out and people were leaving, you know, jobs and businesses were closing and stuff. And my job didn't, I had to stay till the end. I was in human service field. You know, they weren't coming for those guys anytime early. So I was stuck, but everyone else, you know, everyone else wasn't in that field was going home. And I remember our church holding a special midweek service and everyone was all freaked out. And I remember I worked with a couple of Christians and one of them came up to me and goes, she was like hyperventilating. She goes, is this the end of the world? Is this the end of the world? Is this the end? And I'm like, breathe. It's not the end of the world. How do you know? I said, it's very simple. We're still here.
Amen. Amen.
I told her that I knew that it wasn't the end of the world because we were still here. The church was still here. How did I know that? How did I know that it wasn't the end of the world? Because let me tell you something. You know what the Jehovah's Witnesses teach their people? They teach their people that that everyone in the world except for Jehovah's Witnesses are going to be destroyed by flame and fire in this cataclysmic world event. And that if you're not a Jehovah's Witness, you're going to die a horrible death. You're going to get burned up in the flames of destruction. And so when you looked at 9/11, when you looked at the pictures, there was fire and there was soot and there was destruction. People were jumping out of the towers and splattering on the ground. People were dying horrible deaths. There was this one Jehovah's Witness family that really thought it was the end of the world, and the husband went out and bought a shotgun and shot everyone in his family because of it. There's more to the story than that, but I just wanted to give you the dramatic effect of it. Why? Because they were not collected in their spirit. They didn't have hope. They didn't have the gospel, the good news. They had this crazy false religion that was telling them lies. And how do I know that they were? Because the Word of God doesn't say that the believer is going to suffer the wrath of God. In fact, in 1 Thessalonians 5:9, it says, we are not appointed to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And these people, these were Christians. So Paul wasn't talking about eternal wrath. He wasn't talking about them going to hell. They weren't worried about going to hell. They were worried, are we going to go through the tribulation? Are we going to suffer the wrath of God? And Paul says, no, you're not appointed to suffer wrath. In fact, you know what? He commended them early on in the book because they must have started to get the message. Because in chapter 1, he says, chapter 1, verse 9 of 1 Thessalonians, it has been reported to us how you have turned from your idols. You are serving the living God, and you are waiting for the Son from heaven, whom God raised from the dead. These Thessalonians were doing exactly what a good Christian should be doing. First, you got to get saved. You got to turn away from your false gods, your idols. That's what an idol is. It's a false god. And you know what? It doesn't have to be Buddha or Muhammad or Allah or Jehovah Witness or the billions of Hindu gods. It can be a career. It can be money. It can be your family. It can be whatever you worship. It could be a stone. It could be a lizard. God used me a couple weeks ago to lead a young lady into the kingdom of God. You know what God, her mom, was serving? She said, I feel guilty for coming here. I go, why? She goes, because my mom serves the demon. That's what she said. Serves the demon. And I said, well, I serve Jesus. and he is greater than any demon. You don't have to feel guilty. I was amazed. Most of the time as a pastor, I see people feeling guilty because they don't go to church. She was the first person that confessed to me she was guilty because she came to church. If you don't think God doesn't have a sense of humor, you're missing the point. He does. He loves us, and he has good news for us. And let's finish this off, and let's conclude this. Verse 7, he says, "For those who sleep at night, those who get drunk are drunk at night, but let us who have the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet the hope of salvation, for God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we're awake, alive, or asleep, dead, we should live together with him. Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you are already doing." In fact, Paul is saying, look, just the opposite. We are not called to wrath. We're called to God's salvation. Now, a lot of people think salvation is only what we talk about, you know, we put our faith in Jesus 2,000 years ago. No. Salvation is not only a faith and an act already happen. It's a process in which you live, and it's an expectation which you look for, all at the same time. In fact, the Greek kind of proves it, because if I looked up that word salvation, it's right here. Okay, I got this one. And it comes from the Greek word soteria, where we get our deep theological soteriology, the study of salvation. Okay, and this is what it means: deliverance, preservation, safety, salvation, deliverance from molestation of enemies, deliverance in an ethical sense, which concludes at the soul's safety or salvation, messianic salvation, salvation as the present possession of all true Christians, future salvation, the sum benefits and blessings which the Christians redeemed from all earthly ills will enjoy after the visible return of Christ from heaven in the consummated and eternal kingdom of God. Wow. Salvation from the past, our sins, salvation from the present, our present day issues that we have, and salvation from the future. That's our hope. And that's why it's so important. This message needs to go out, guys. Because if you notice when we were in Peter, he said that we could hasten the day. How do we do that? Well, Paul tells us in Romans 11, 25, it says, when the fullness of the Gentiles be come in, that's when the rapture is going to occur. How can we hasten the return of Jesus Christ? We need to be fishers of men. We need to go after that last Gentile. And I want to say this. If you're not Jewish, you're Gentile, okay? Just so there's no understanding. And if you're not saved right now, will you please get saved? You're holding us up. We want to go home. Okay? You might be saying, well, how do I get saved? It's very simple. It's very simple. I'm going to close with this. John chapter 1. Verses 11 through 13. This is what John the Revelator, the guy who wrote the book of Revelation, he also wrote this book. This is what he said about salvation. He said that he, Jesus, came to his own, the Jews, and his own received him not. But to as many as received him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God, even to those who believe upon his name, who are not born by the will of man, nor by the will of flesh, but born by the will of God. How do you get ready for the rapture? You must be born again. Amen. If you're not born again, you can't enter the kingdom of God. You can't even see the kingdom of God. See, I see it because I'm born again. I see it all the time. I see it everywhere. Do you realize that one out of every 13 verses in the New Testament talks about Jesus Christ coming back? Do you realize I could go on and on for hours and hours and hours and give you passage after passage after passage after passage that tells us that we're to be watching and waiting and praying? Constantly. It's all through the New Testament. So why is this being torn apart with false teaching? Because the devil knows how powerful it is. When I was a street evangelist, there were two things that I would preach on that result, when I preached on these two things, if there were unsaved people, they got saved. The first one was the cross. The preaching of the cross is the power of salvation to those who believe. Jesus died for us and saved us. The other one was the rapture. Jesus is coming back. And so I go back to my question. Who or what are you depending on for your future? And I'll follow up with this question. Are you ready to meet him today? Paul writes, today is the day of salvation. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you're in big trouble. Because I'm telling you, we're real close. When I look at the world events that are going on, when I see the birth pangs that are going on, it's just getting more and more obvious that we're real close. I don't know the day or the hour. I can't tell you, oh yeah, on Monday, September 25th of 2026, Jesus is coming back at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I can't tell you that. And if I try to tell you that, guess what? I'm a false teacher and you should run away from me. Okay? Screaming, ah! But I can tell you this. We need to be living in a constant state of readiness for his return. Let's pray. Father, Lord, I thank you for this incredible hope that you've given to us. You are an awesome God. And Lord, I thank you for this salvation that you've given us. You've promised us that if we live, you live with us and in us, and you'll guide us. And if we die, we get to meet you in heaven. And if we do that, we'll be part of the dead in Christ who get raised at the rapture before those who are alive in Christ. What a great God you are. Father, I pray right now, if there's anyone here in the hearing of my voice that does not know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, my prayer for them is that they would get saved, that you would bring them into the kingdom of God, that you would show them what is being taught here is true. And Lord, I thank you for this time, and I ask that you bless us through the remainder of this day. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're a listener who doesn't know Jesus Christ, if you're not born again of God's Spirit, today's the day of salvation. Jesus could come back right now. And if he were to come back right now, and if you're not saved, you're going to get left behind and you're going to have to meet the most horrible person this world has ever seen, the Antichrist. We at First Congregational Church don't want that to happen to you. And so we ask you, come to Jesus, accept him into your heart. And if you would just pray this real simple prayer with me, you can punch your ticket for the rapture on Airline Jesus. So just pray with me. Dear Jesus, I believe that I am a sinner. I believe that you are the Son of God. I ask you to forgive me for my sins, to cleanse me from my iniquities. Come into my life. Be my Lord. Be my God. Be my Savior. I surrender to you. I ask that you would do this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you did that for the first time, happy birthday. Today truly was your day of salvation. One last favor I ask of you. If you could just go and tell a Bible preaching pastor or friend, someone you trust, what you did. Tell them how you accepted Christ into your heart. Because there's something about speaking out what we do that builds up our faith in Jesus. Well, from the rest of us at First Congregational Church, we'll see you next week, and may God bless you all the days of your life.